فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. The Sheikh whose kitab we're studying, الفرائد البهية في نظم قواعد الفقهية by Sheikh Abu Bakr ibn Abi al-Qasim al-Ahdal رحمه الله تعالى، he said الحمد لله الذي فقهنا ولسلوك شرعه نبهنا. The Sheikh started his book by saying يقول, and we spoke about that last lesson. Now the Sheikh says Alhamdulillah, praises to Allah. This Alhamdulillah, it goes back to the speech of the author. In other words, this is the maf'ul of the fi'l of yaqulu. And yaqulu, he says. Raji, the one who has the hope, which is the fa'il. So where's the maf'ul? What is it that he is saying, the one who is hoping? The thing that he is saying is Alhamdulillah. But the maf'ul here, the grammarians, they dispute amongst themselves. They said, is it maf'ul bihi or is it maf'ul mutlaq? Is it maf'ul bihi? لأن the قول and the thing that it's rooted from, it places nasb over a maf'ul that is agreed upon based on the grammarians. Like in the question that they have within themselves is it a maf'ul bih or is it maf'ul mutlaq? This is another whole different discussion. Like in the strongest is that it's a maf'ul bih. Like in here, the maf'ul bih is not a word, it is a jumla, it's the whole sentence. Alhamdulillahi is the whole maf'ul bih. The whole jumla, the whole sentence is fi maqami maf'ul bih, is in the position of a maf'ul bih. So remember what we took, my beloved brothers and sisters. What we took was that when we spoke about yaqulu, we spoke about maqulu qawl. And we said that the maqulu qawl, the condition for it is an yakuna jumla aw mufradan fi ma'na al-jumla. That it has to be a jumla or it has to be in the place of a jumla. That's what we said when we were discussing it. So what does it mean that the maqul qawl has to be a jumla? The example for it is Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah is not a jumla. Alhamdulillah is a jumla. Are you with me, brothers? And when I say jumla, jumla means it's the synonym of kalam. Remember what was the ta'rif of kalam? Huwa al-lafdhu al-murakkabu al-mufidu bil-wad'i. Jumla and kalam are synonyms, they mean the same. In other words, it is either a jumla ismiya or jumla fi'liya. That's a jumla. It's a complete sentence. Are you with me? That either consists of its mubtada and its khabar, which is the alhamdulillahi. Alhamdu is a mubtada, alillahi is a khabar. Are you with me? Or it can be a fi'l and a fa'il and a maf'ul bi, that's a jumla. Are you with me? So here, Alhamdu is a jumla, it's a sentence. It has its mubtada and its khabar. It starts with Alhamdu, Hamdu is jumla ismiya. Are you with me, brothers? It's a jumla ismiya murakaba. It consists of a mubtada and it consists of a khabar. And the mubtada and the khabar, look what you say. You say Alhamdu mubtada, lillahi khabar. And then together, they are sitting in the place of maf'ul bih. You know, together, in the place of what? Maf'ul bih. Which is the what? نصب وقول قول يقول راجي الحمد لله. That's what it is. All of the other points inside it, يقول راجي الحمد لله. That's what it is. Does that make sense? So here the question, so now we understood when you said the مقول قول has to be a jumla. الحمد لله is an example. Good, جميل, فهمنا. But what do we mean when you say it has to be a مفردا singular, but it means a jumla? What do you mean by that? What we mean by that is one word that a person says. So for example, a person says, قُلْتُ خُطْبَةً. قُلْتُ, I have said, خُطْبَةً. Where's the مَقُولُ قَوْلُ here? قُلْتُ, the قَاف, the قَالَ is here, فِعِلْ مَاضِي مَبْنِيَ عَلَى الْفَتْحِ. مَبْنِيَ عَلَى الْفَتْحِ لَا مَحَلَّ لَهُ مِنَ الْإِعْرَابِ. The تَاءِ الضَّمِيرُ مُتَّصِلٌ فِي مَحَلِّ رَفْعِ فَاعِلْ. So we have قُلْتُ, we've done that. خُطْبَةً is what? خُطْبَةً is the مَفْعُولُ بِهِ, right? And it is what? It is the مَقُولُ قَوْلُ. The question here is, but did you just say it has to be a jumla? And khutbatan is not a jumla. Alhamdulillah is a jumla. Khutbatan is just one word. It has no mubtada and a khabar. It is not a jumla fi'liya. What is it? We say khutbah here is a ma'na of jumla. How is it? The khutbah that the person gives, there's so many sentences inside it. Fahim too? Are you guys with me? Fahimtum? That is what it is meant by that the maqulu qawl can be a jumla or it can be mufradan, singular, fi ma'na al-jumla. Because the khutbah is an hour long or it takes time. It's just not one word. There's no khutbah, that's just one word. Are you with me? So here is ma'na, ma'na al-jumla, ma'na al-kalam. Alhamdu. Then we all agree what Alhamdulillah is what? Is a maqulu? Maqulu qawl. And the question is, it came as what? The maqulu qawl here, it came as a what? Is it a jumlah? Or is it mufradan fi ma'na al-jumlah? Which one has it come as? It came as a jumlah. What type of jumlah has it come as? Jumlah ismiya. Why has it come as jumlah ismiya, not jumlah fa'liya? Why like in jumla ismiya? Why? Why didn't it come as a jumla fa'liya? Why didn't he say, instead of saying alhamdu, why didn't he say nahmadu? Nahmadullaha. Why didn't he say that? And make it into a jumla fa'liya? The reason the scholars they say is because لِدَلَالَةِ عَلَى الْإِسْتِمْرَارِ وَالْدَوَامِ. So the ism, it shows continuation. And it shows consistency. It has that meaning in it, that this is consistent. The praising of Allah here is going to forever go. Good. Alhamdu here, brothers, here is jumla what? Ismiya. It's a what? It's a jumla ismiya. If it's a jumla ismiya, then it comes as the meaning of khabariyatun lafzan insha'iyatun ma'nan. It's when somebody comes up to you today and says to you, Jazakallahu khayran. May Allah reward you with good. Brothers, pay attention. Jazakallahu khayran. May Allah reward you. Reward you with good. Are you with me, brothers? No. Does that mean Jazakallahu khayran? Does it say may Allah reward you? Is that what he says? Jaza, what is it? What is it in Arabic grammar? Jaza. It's a past verb. It's a fi'il madhi. Allah has rewarded you with good. Are you with me, brothers? But then when we translate it, we say, may Allah reward you with good. The same is sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is past tense. Allah has sent on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah has sent down on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam rahmah, and Allah praises him subhanahu wa ta'ala in his gathering, based on the two opinions that are out there. But there is not say, we're not saying, oh Allah, praise him, exalt him, or you know, send salutation. We're not saying that. This is called the wording. Yes, is khabar. It's informing you of something. Are you with me? So here when we say Alhamdulillah, we're saying Unshi'u alhamda, I'm initiating a praise. That is what we're saying. وَلِذَلِكَ, the difference between khabar and insha is that khabar is something you can say to a person, you're lying. And you can say to somebody, you're telling the truth. If I said to you right now, I just came from home, that is either something you can say you're right, you're telling the truth, or no, you're not telling the truth, you're lying. Insha doesn't mean that. And insha can't be said you're lying or you're telling the truth. It's for me saying to you, may Allah reward you. It is dua, or me saying to you, give me your phone. You can't say you're lying. Are you with me? So insha is a dua. It is a talab, requesting, or a command, amar, nahi. All of those are insha. It's something you can't say, you're lying. And it is something you can't say what? You're telling the truth. So here, alhamdulillah is a khabariyah lafzan, insha'iyah ma'anan. What does alhamdu lughatan mean? What meaning does alhamdu actually mean? Lughatan. Alhamdu lughatan, my beloved brothers and sisters, it means huwathana. It is to praise. And this is the common definition that people give. Are you with me, brothers? So inshallah ta'ala, we're going to have to look at it together. People, lughatan, the scholars, they define it as al-thana'u. Huwathana'u. Huwathana'u is to praise. Bisifatil jamila, it is to praise with good characteristics. You're praising a person with something good, noble characteristics which they hold. Akhi, wallahi, you're a trustworthy person. That's hamd. Are you with me? Who a thana'u, it is to praise. Bisifatil jamila, great characteristics. Wal af'alil hasana, and good actions that the person does. The person has values in them, things that are noble. And good acts that the person does. Look what they say after that. Sawa'un, it doesn't matter, kana fi dhalika muqabalatin ni'ma. It doesn't matter whether it is due to a blessing that the person has bestowed upon you, or if it's not. It doesn't matter. It is the fact that the person is like this. So you can praise a person for being tall. That's not something they're doing for you. That is not something that they're passing over onto you. But you're praising them for something they are for themselves. As for istilahan technically, and I'm going to come back to the ta'qibat of these definitions, is the definition that many people say when they define hamda. They say بِأَنَّهُ فِعْل, it is an action يُنْبِئُ that initiates and comes from عَنْ تَعْظِيمِ الْمُنْعِمِ, honoring the one who has blessed you بِسَبَبِ كَوْنِهِ مُنْعِمًا. He's either bestowed that blessing onto you, or he bestowed it onto somebody else. Meaning, this hamd technically is become due to him having to do for you good. And that is not right. The hamd is not muta'alliqun bil in'am. It is not connected for you doing something for me. Are you with me? Rather, the hamd yata'allaqu bi jami'i sifatil jamila wal af'alil hasana. It is connected to all good characteristics and attributes that are present in that individual, or any good acts which are in them. That is what hamd means. But like Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he defined it better than all of those definitions that you find. Also Ibn al-Qayyim did the same, copied Ibn Taymiyyah, which is what? Huwa wasful mahmudi. It is to describe the one you're praising بصفات الكمال with complete characteristics. Mahabbatan wa ta'zeeman, out of love and honoring him. Why did they add the word out of love and honoring? Why? What's the reason of adding the word love and honoring? La. This is where they differ between madh and hamd. Madh is to praise, and hamd is to praise. So how do you distinguish between it? Madh is when you just praise a person, you don't even love them, you're not honoring them. This is called madh. Lakin alhamd is when you are doing it, it's out of love. And out of honoring is when you're doing it. Are you with me? And yes, you're right, in the sense where hamd is a ibadah. Madh is not an ibadah. Does it make sense? So, Ibn Taymiyyah's definition is the best. It's very good. Alayhi rahmatullah, which is wasful mahmudi. It is to describe the one you're praising. Bisifatil kamali, with complete characteristics and attributes. Mahabbatan, out of love. Wata'zeeman, and out of honoring him. Yeah? And that's how we find, Ibn al-Qayyim literally pointed that out. He said, فَإِنَّ تَجَرُّدَ الْحَمْدِ عَنِ الْمَحَبَّةِ وَالتَّعْظِيمِ فَهُوَ مَدْحٌ. You see? Stripping the mahabba, the love, and the honoring from the hamd is madh. And if you attach وَإِنِ اقْتَرَنَ بِالْحَمْدِ مَحَبَّةِ وَتَعْظِيمًا, if love and honoring is connected to the hamd, فَهُوَ حَمْدٌ. This becomes hamd, it is not madh. Are you with me, brothers? It's very important. So here we learn, وَبِهَذَا نَعْرِفُ الْفَرْقَ بَيْنَ الْحَمْدِ وَالْمَدْحِ. Now we know the difference between hamd and madh. Pay attention here with me now. Here another issue arose. Another issue, it arose and it came to light for some scholars, which is the issue of this statement of saying huwa thana. Ibn Taymiyyah, he didn't use that word. He didn't use the word thana. What did he use? Wasful Mahmud, to describe. Whereas others, they say what? Thana. Are you with me, brothers? So some scholars, they said thana and hamd, to describe thana as hamd is actually incorrect. Hamd is not thana. And they didn't allow that. And the evidence that they used for that was that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting one day, فَمُرَّ بِجَنَازَةٍ, a janazah was brought to him عليه الصلاة والسلام, was brought by him. The hadith, look what it says. Are you with me, brothers? It was brought to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a janazah, and it was brought by him. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the people around him, they what? فَأَثْنَوْ عَلَيْهَا خَيْرًا. They praise. Look what he says. فَأَثْنَوْ عَلَيْهَا خَيْرًا. فَأَثْنَوْ عَلَيْهَا خَيْرًا. So the thana here, it shows that it's khayr, right? Then the Prophet ﷺ said, based on what you guys have said, based on what they said, the Prophet said, وَجَبَتْ. Then Jannah is promised for this person. In other words, the people are shuhada'ullahi ala al-ard. The people on this earth are testimony on the face of this earth. They are witnesses over you. They know you. You know. They know your situation. وَمُرَّ بِجَنَازَةٍ. Another janazah was brought by the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Look what the narration says. فَأَثْنَوْ عَلَيْهَا شَرًّا. فَأَثْنَوْ عَلَيْهَا شَرًّا. So the word thana can't be praise. The Prophet ﷺ then said, وَجَبَتْ. It's wajib for it. Jahannam is wajib for this person. So then they said, based on this, الثنائي, the word ثناء, are you with me, brothers? ثناء is يطلق على الشر, and it is also يطلق على الخير. الثناء is something that is used for خير and شر. Are you with me, brothers? Are you with me, brothers? So based on that, they said no. The other scholars, they responded. Is the argument very strong? Yeah? The argument is very strong. The other scholars have come and they said, لا. They said, inshallah ta'ala, بإذن الله الكريم, we will take inshallah al-jawhar al-maqnoon, بإذن الله in علم البلاغة. علم البلاغة in أنواع المجاز, when the scholars, they talk about majaz, when they talk about al-majaz. Within majaz, there's something known as al-mushakala. There's something that they know as mushakala, which means, in simple terms, in simplicity, to simplify it very much, is that sometimes a word follows the word before it just so the rhyme and the continuation of the issue carries on the same. Because أثنوا عليها خيراً was said, it makes more sense to just bring the word back again من باب المشاكلة, from the angle of it just being the same of what was just mentioned. So they أثنوا عليها خيراً, when it was said, okay, أثنوا عليها شرًا, just say. لكن في حقيقتها, in its real, this is majaz, this is not haqiqah. The word thana, in its literal meaning, it means only khair. And when it was used for it being athna wa alayha sharran, they said this is mushakala, which is a topic of majaz. And you know majaz, you guys can't base that on a reality. Majaz is metaphor. Does that make sense? Metaphor. So yeah, that is the argument based on that. Now the question arises, and the question that comes, which is, what is the difference between Alhamd and Ash-Shukr? Before we go into that, for us to understand it very well, where does Hamd occur from? And where does it happen from? A line of poetry summarizes it. A line of poetry summarizes it, which is what? أفادتكم النعماء مني ثلاثة. أفادتكم النعماء مني ثلاثة. يدي ولساني. يدي ولساني والضمير المحجبي. My أفادتكم النعماء مني ثلاثة. Three places. First one is what? يدي, my hand. Are you with me? Which is a? Which is hand. وَلِسَانِي am I? My tongue. وَلِسَانِي وَالضَّمِيرُ الْمُحَجَّبِي. وَلِسَانِي وَالضَّمِيرُ الْمُحَجَّبِي. يَدِي وَلِسَانِي, both of them are what? They are kinayatun عَنِ الْجَوَالِحِ. They are referring to the limbs. Are you with me? Both of them. The hand is a limb and the tongue is a limb, right? Or a body part. You with me? So the person, he praises from the what? That's what some scholars said. They said that the hamd, it occurs from those three places. That it comes from the lisan. This is the shukr. The shukr is those three places. The shukr occurs from those three places. I did a mistake. Ash-shukru yakunu bil-lisan. The shukr is what happens from the tongue. And it happens from the limbs. And it happens from the heart. Those are the three places where the shukr occurs from. Sorry. أَفَادَتْكُمُ النَّعْمَاءُ مِنِّي ثَلَاثَةً يَدِي وَلِسَانِي وَالضَّمِيرُ الْمُحَجَّبِ. All of that is what? It occurs from the person's tongue. It occurs from the person's body parts, it occurs from the person's heart. That's shukr. لذلك الله said in the Quran, اعملوا آل داود شكرا. The people of آل داود, do shukr. Shukr is something that can be done. As for hamd, مختص باللسان. The hamd is specific to the tongue. أن الحمد مختص باللسان. So from that, what do we realize, brothers? The difference here, what do we realize? Who's more general, who is more bigger here? The shukr is bigger, because the shukr occurs from where? It occurs from the tongue, it occurs from the body parts and the limbs, and it also occurs from the heart. Does that make sense? Shukr, you can say it from your tongue. You can do it with your body parts. You can also in your heart. That's the statement of أَفَادَتْكُمُ النَّعْمَةُ مِنِّي ثَلَاثَةً يَدِي وَلِسَانِي وَالضَّمِيرُ الْمُحَجَّبِ. The ضمير المحجب means the heart. As for the hamdala, the hamd, my brothers, it only occurs from the tongue and the heart. Those two. It doesn't have no place on the body parts, on the person's limbs. They can't do any action to do it. They can say it and they can have it in their heart. Are you with me? They say it with their heart. that is the difference between the two of them. So who is here right now more broader and more general? Shukr. That is when the scholars, they say from this angle, shukr has a more broader and it's more bigger than alhamd. Are you with me, brothers? There is also another angle of looking at it, whereas hamd is now broader than a shukr, which is that alhamd is, as I mentioned before, it is not muqabalatun ni'mah, it is not in response to a blessing that was bestowed upon you. Hamd is not, you praise a person for things that they have not done for you. You can praise them for what they are and qualities and characteristics which they carry that may not have anything to do with you. Does that make sense? From this angle, alhamdu is more broader, whereas shukr is muqabalatun ni'mah. is in response to something that the person has done for you. Shukr is what? Muqabalatun ni'mah. It is respond, and it is a in response to a thing that the person has done for you. Are you with me? Are you with me, brothers? In other words, simple terms, it is the shukr is only connected to the sifat which are sifat that are sifat which are lazima, the characteristics of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala that are lazim, that are always with Him. The actions of Allah which are muta'adiyah, the characteristics which are muta'adiyah, not only the Allah but also the creations ones. The sifat which are dhatiyah, the sifat which are dhatiyah, lazima, that's what shukr is connected to. Whereas the hamd is connected to sifat which are dhatiyah, and it's also connected to sifat which are muta'adiyah. Muta'adiyah, the transitive characteristics. So that is why it's important that the person learns the difference between a shukr and alhamd, and also the difference between alhamd and al-madh, and also the khilaf regarding the scholars who mentioned the issue of al-thana. So here, what do we say? The qa'ida is baynahuma umumun wa khusus. There's between the two of them, alhamdu and al-shukr, between the two of them is what? Between the two of them is umum, generalization and specification. Umum, khusus. Meaning sometimes the hamd is general, the hamd is general and the shukr is specific. And sometimes the shukr is general and the hamd is specific. That is what it is. Alhamdulillahi, the alif al-lam, that are in alhamdu. What is it? Is it istighraqiyya? Is it jinsiyya? Which of those two is it? Which of the two is it? The scholars, they discussed it amongst themselves. You said it's what? Some scholars, they said it's jinsiyya. Meaning, jinsul hamd, the hamd in and within itself, is for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. That is what jinsiyya means. Whereas, istighraqiyya means Alhamdu kulluha, all of hamd lillahi azza wa jalla is for Allah. All of hamd is for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Those who said all of hamd is for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, then the question is, can you not do hamd for anybody other than Allah? And we have the hadith of who? The hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. When Qissatul Ifki, she was accused falsely. Those forged statements were made against her, radiallahu ta'ala anha, al-mubarri'ah, min fawqi sab'a samawat. Hadith came with that Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, don't praise me. So she used the word hamd. So if alhamd is only for Allah, that Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was only refusing it and she didn't want it, was because why? She believed her answer came from Allah, nobody else. Nobody helped her. And Ahmaduka in Arabic, you can say to anybody other than Allah, I praise you. Ala ma qumta alayhi, in that which you have stood up for and what you have done and whatnot. You can. So if we say it's istighraqiyya, this issue occurs. Are you with me? So there's discussion, Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, he tries to respond to that and answer what it means. And others also do the same.